ॐ सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ ॐ मे हि प्रोटेक्ट अस बोथ मे हि नॉरिश अस बोथ मे वी बोथ वर्क टुगेदर विथ ग्रेट एनर्जी मे अवर स्टडी बी थरू एंड फ्रूटफुल मे वी नेवर हेट ईच अदर ॐ पीस 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 बी अनटू ऑल
ॐ जननीं शारदां देवीं रामकृष्णं जगद्गुरुं पादपद्मे तयोश्रित्वा प्रणमामि मुहुर्मुहुः ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः.
इन् अवर् लास्ट् क्लास् वि डिस्कस्ड् टु वेरि इम्पार्टेण्ट् पायिण्ट्स्. दि फस्ट् पायिण्ट् इस् whenever we progress in any field of life, that means whenever we gain some new knowledge, and that knowledge must bring about corresponding changes in our behavior. Both understanding and behavior, they always go together. You can never separate them. The moment you understand this is good, then you go after it. Whether the understanding is right or wrong, I'm not talking. Any type of knowledge must bring about changes. That is the first point. The second point, the most important point we discussed. Sri Ramakrishna had his full first vision of the Divine Mother. First vision. What type of vision he had? Why am I bringing up this discussion? Supposing you are worshipping Sri Ram, say Krishna. And for a long time you did. You are praying, oh Lord, let me see. What's your concept? What type of vision you are going to have? What is the concept you have? Usual concept is, as I have been seeing in the picture or in the image, I would like to see Krishna in the same way. I also made a little bit of fun. Suppose he grants your prayer, but comes in the form of a Texas cowboy. Would you accept him? You would not accept. This is our concept of, because we are very much bound, limited by our idea of what God is like. The whole spiritual practice is to break these boundaries, and the more we break the limitations, form slowly merges into formlessness. The Ramakrishna gives a beautiful example. And supposing you are on the ground level, and you see various trees, tamarind trees, mango trees, coconut trees, etc., etc. You can clearly distinguish each tree, even a plant, very clearly. Supposing you get up onto a high hill, from that top, how do all these various trees look like? You know, more or less the same. You cannot distinguish. What has happened now? Distinguishing requires you must be able to know the forms. This is this form, therefore I recognize. How do you recognize anybody? I'll give you a funny example. Supposing a man had a goat, and he's a meat eater, he has got a goat. Then he's very fond of his goat. Then he sells the goat to a butcher. And next day, the butcher had butchered it along with other goats, and then hanging after skinning. And you go there and say, I would like to see my beloved goat. He says, it is here. Look at it. Find out. Can he find out? Why is it? Because that particular distinguishing features of the goat have been removed. He said, this distinguishing features is called form. Once the distance occurs in some way or other, the form slowly merges into what? Formlessness. So, if we are thinking about God, God, say Krishna has a form, Rama has a form, etc., etc. That is only when our mind is extremely limited. The moment we go beyond those limitations, and we have to go, because your mind never will accept Krishna has got a form. You cannot accept God with form. It is very painful. You just imagine Vishnu, your favorite chosen deity is Vishnu or Kali. My God, with all those knife and skull, she is heavily walking like that. Have you ever seen a thin Kali? If walking like that, would you like to have her vision at midnight? Yeah, interesting. You go to the temple and then you see Mother Kali there. You bow down, sashtanga pranam and stuti and coconut and goat, depending upon your South Indian or North Indian. And then this, I had vision of Mother Kali. One day you are walking in a very lonely forest. Suddenly at midnight, Mother Kali comes like that. What's your opinion of that? Would you fall down and say, this is Mother Kali? Or you say, this is the worst ghostess? What do you say? What is my point? When our mind breaks down these barriers, breaking down, that means expands. When the mind's ideas expand, automatically forms transform themselves into formlessness. There is no other choice. This is the only way we can do it. When Sri Ramakrishna had this vision of Mother Kali, what was the type of vision he had? Last time we have graphically described. In the form of what? Pure consciousness. In the form of pure consciousness. But when his mind was coming down from that pure identity with consciousness. Pure identity means what? I am consciousness. When the mind is coming down, at this lower level, again he will have the Divine Mother, but not in the physical way, but imagining a body of light, etc., Jyoti Rupini, like that. So that's what we discussed. After that, what happened? After that first vision, what happens? There is a beautiful saying in Bengali language, Ami Chini Hote China, Ami Chini Khete Chai. I do not wish to become sugar, I wish to enjoy sugar. But Swami Brahmananji says, this is a statement of a person who never tasted sugar. Once the person had tasted sugar, what would be his idea? Always, I want to taste sugar only. The only way to taste sugar always is what? To become sugar. That is an important point. After the first vision, the Ramakrishna became like that. I don't want to taste sugar. I want to become sugar. That means I do not want any separation, even for a single second, from the Divine Mother. So we're reading some of this. This is chapter 7 from the Sri Ramakrishna, the great master, sadhana and divine inebriation. First, straight after the first vision. The master became quite unfit for all work for some days on account of the bliss arising from the vision of the mother. It became impossible for him to perform regularly the worship and other duties of the temple. Now, why was it impossible? Because when we are experiencing such a state of mind, for which purpose we have worked such a long time, it is impossible to come down from that state. Work and its result. Karma and karma phala. Why do people work? For the sake of karma phala. And once the phala has come and we are enjoying it, as I will give a very crude example. Supposing a person is very fond of nice sweet mangoes and he is poor. He had to earn. So he works whole day and then he gets the mango and he just took his first bite. After that, tell him, no, this mango you keep aside and you go and work. Will he do it? He will not do it. Because this is the purpose for which he had worked the whole day. That is our condition. That's why no man will work. Not only that, there is a law. How long does a person really work? Very interesting question. How long does a person work? Actually, karma is meant for what purpose? Karma phala. What is karma phala? What is the end result of any action? Ananda. To experience bliss, happiness, unbroken happiness. Once a person is experiencing happiness, would he like to go back to work? Only when it comes to an end, and if there is no other way, then only he will go back to work. Now, what is the point here? What is the result of so much of spiritual sadhana? Only to enjoy the bliss. And Sri Ramakrishna had already started enjoying it. He doesn't want to be 1 second, millisecond, separated from that happiness. Now, my question, very interesting question. Given a choice, you will be given our karma phala. Will you do karma? Think deeply. If your hospital is paying all your salary without you are doing anything, would you go? You will not go. I know what is troubling you. what is troubling you? What is troubling you is, what do I do with my time? When they give money, what do I do? But when a person becomes restless and wants to spend all his time, is it for the sake of karma or is it for the sake of happiness? You have to understand this question properly. The person is unhappy. That unhappiness expresses itself in the form of restlessness. He is not keen on work. Work is an escape for him from getting out of that condition called boredom. When a person is bored, do you call him happy or unhappy? When a person is happy, will he be bored? So when a person is happy, if you ask him, will he do any work? Because work is positively an obstruction for enjoying happiness. This is a law, you will have to understand it. Any work is a distraction, an obstacle for ananda. Have you ever thought about it? Just now we dealt with that point. When a person says, I am enjoying work, he is doing work for this, not for the sake of work, for the sake of happiness. That is the ultimate. This is called Krishna Karma Krit. A person who obtains unceasing bliss, he has no work in this world. He only Atmaiva Atmanatushta in Bhagavad Gita class, Prajahati Yada Kaman, Sarvan Partha Manogatan, Atmaneva Atmanatushta, Sthita Pragnaha Tada Uchyate. When you are happy constantly, then you don't want any work, because work is coming down from the state of happiness. Work is a distraction and you don't want any distraction. I'll give you an example also. Nobody wants work. Supposing, imagine somebody offers you two fruits and says, you choose, what do you want? One is Indian pomegranate. Another is beautiful fuzzy mango. Which one would you prefer? Point, it is pure work, isn't it? So, dana by dana, you have to remove it. If somebody offers after doing all those things, it is a different issue. Here is a fruit, and that too not Kabul's Afghanistan pomegranate. That Indian white, you know, small, sticky, and all those things. Now, do you get what the point I want? Karma and happiness are opposed to each other. That's why Shankaracharya is totally opposite to karma. But we should not misunderstand his statement. He says karma has its value until it starts yielding certain type of result, which is happiness. Once karma starts yielding that result, you don't need to cling to it because its purpose is done. Once the boat has reached the city of joy, you don't need the boat any longer. That is the idea. Sri Ramakrishna's condition was like that. He was unable because he was not even conscious. He was only conscious of the Divine Mother. Then how all these duties are going to do? That's why he said, first few days it became impossible for Sri Ramakrishna to perform regularly the worship and other duties of the temple. A pujari has got many other duties. Not that he will go and simply sit. He has to clean, he has to decorate, he has to prepare for the puja. It's very hard work. Then Hriday somehow managed these works with the help of another Brahmin. But how long can he go on doing it? Second, the master's physical sensations and mental perceptions at this time. The master proceeded to perform the worship on some days when he did not become totally overwhelmed with divine consciousness. He told us sometimes a little of the thoughts and experiences at the time of his worship and meditation in those days. Sri Ramakrishna, after the first vision, remember, sometimes his mind used to come a little bit down so that it permitted him to do on some days a little bit of the worship. But this time, the change is total. What is it? Previously, he was longing for that vision. Now his mind is absorbed in that vision. Sometimes when the mind comes down, he becomes restless. At that time, some days he used to worship, other days he could not do it, and some days when he sat for this worship, he forgot time, space, which comes first, which comes later, what should be done first, what should be done next. You know that krama, everything has become upside down. That is being described here. The Ramakrishna reminisced, I used to show to my mind the image of Bhairava. If you had visited Dakshineswar, you will see that when you stand in front of the Divine Mother and look at that hall in front of it, not Mandir. On the top, there is a small figure of Bhairava. Sri Ramakrishna is referring, I used to show that figure of Bhairava and say, you must be firm and motionless like it and meditate on Mother's lotus feet. No sooner had I sat down for meditation than I heard clattering sounds produced in the joints of my body and limbs for as long as I meditated, as though somebody has locked his joints. That means he had no freedom even to move, like a person who is tied with chains, like that. But who did this tying? His own mind. His own mind, you can say Divine Mother, but his own mind. That means, what a firm suggestion. This is what hypnotic people, they do it, hypnosis. They will hypnotize a person and says, you cannot lift your hand until I give my permission to do it. You know hypnosis? What is hypnosis? That state of mind where we give suggestions to our own self, and that suggestion becomes so strong, whatever the suggestion, the body obeys in toto. Wonderful phenomena. It is being used now, hypnotherapy they call it, to cure certain type of disabilities and disease, mental diseases mostly, even physically. This is a kind of self-hypnosis. By whom? By Sri Ramakrishna. I had no power to move my body and change my posture even slightly, or give up meditation and go elsewhere, or do anything else at will. As if after the meditation period is over, and then the Divine Mother as if unlocks all the things, then he is free. And who decides how much time he should sit for meditation? Who decides? He himself, in the form of the Divine Mother. This is called, you know, surrendering one's will into the Divine will. Say it is Divine Mother's will, or you can also say His will. And that's what happens through our karma. We join our will to the Divine will, so that the Divine will works only according to the karma that we have done. This is the law of karma. Supposing you decided, your will decides, and it is always that I will become a doctor, I will get first class, I will get only third class, and I will fail. Who decides who fails or not? Divine Mother or you? We decide. How do we know? Because our action follows our thoughts. So the person, he doesn't say openly, if I could get first class without any study, that would be really wonderful. But what he says is, I don't want to study. That means what is he saying? If I don't want to study, then what would be the result? So there is a connection, because our will is also part of the Divine will. I'll give another example. These are very, very deep ideas. You have to grasp them. What type of dreams you have? Tell me. First of all, do you have any control over your dreams? The answer is no. That is total bunk, because then who comes in? Do I come and then decide your dreams? Who decides our dreams? Ourselves. But how do we do it? Okay, I'll give even more graphic example. Suppose here is a child and he had a nightmare. Did he decide that I will have a nightmare? If you ask him, did you want nightmare? He will say, no, I didn't want nightmare. But you ask him, what type of nightmare? I saw a demon coming like this to grasp me. And why did you have such kind of dream? Because just before that, I read this Chandamama, where this demon has come and then grasping somebody. That somebody becomes me later on in the dream. Because I am putting myself when I am reading in the position of Sindhubad or whatever it is, isn't it? And who asked him to read that book? And who asked him to read that book just before sleeping? He himself has done. And why was he reading that book? If you ask him, because I get joy only by reading that book. You ask a devotee, why do you have these nasty dreams instead of having divine dreams? Because what type of thoughts you have before going to bed, that determines. Antakalecha, mame smaran muktva kalevaram, tam tame vaiti kaunte sada tadbhava bhavitaha, yam vapi smaran bhavam, tyajatyante kalevaram. Whatever the last thought before we kick our bucket. Our next word is determined by that idea, is it not? This is, we all believe in it. You repeat God's name, you remember God's name, then you attain higher position otherwise. Is it not? What is every night? Mini kicking the bucket for a short time. Is it not? That MM of Smaran Bhavam. What is the last thought before you go to bed? That would determine what? The type of dreams you had. Is it not? Whether it is fear, whether it is expectation, all the, is it not a fact? It's all pure psychology. If you want to have divine dreams, two things are necessary. The first thing is, you must have a deep desire, I would like to see my Ishtadevata gods, at least in the dreams. That is the first thing. What is the second thing? You must do the appropriate things. Go on reading the stories of saints and sages, where they had these visions, vision after vision. And you go thinking about them. What type of dreams you will have?
Divine.
Yes. Even though they are your imaginations, but at least they are divine imaginations, isn't it? Very, very wonderful. This is the psychology. And what is your imagination or what is your constant dream? That becomes a reality in your day-to-day life. This is the simple fact. When a person goes on meditating, who is creating that figure? Himself only. We discussed this elaborately in this. Sri Ramakrishna, the great master, there are two paths. One is the path of not this, neti neti, and another is the path of iti iti. When I sat and meditated, I had in the beginning the vision of particles of light, like groups of fireflies. I saw sometimes all quarters covered with masses of mist-like light, and at other times, I perceived that all things were pervaded by bright waves of light like molten silver. I saw these things sometimes with my eyes shut and sometimes with my eyes open. This is like very beautiful expression. Something like, you know, when a person is obsessed with an idea, even when he opens his eyes, he also sees only what? The same things, either he is fearing or whatever it is. As I told you, that young man who had a tryst with his beloved in the outside the village under the Beni entry at 10 o'clock at night, he saw his beloved who came to meet him. So he rushed and embraced her. And he was in Brahmanandam for a few seconds until moonlight came and he saw it was a black bear. What is the example for? What was his idea? I am going to see my beloved. What did he see? A bear. How did the bear appear to him at that moment? That's what happens. With eyes open, with eyes shut. I did not understand what I saw, nor did I know whether it was good or bad to have such visions. I therefore prayed to the mother with a troubled heart. Mother, I don't understand what is happening to me. I don't know mantras, etc., by which to call thee. Please teach me personally what may enable me to realize the mother. If you do not teach me, who else will teach me? For there is no refuge for me except thee. I used to pray thus with a concentrated mind and weep piteously on account of the eagerness of my heart. All these were happening when? After the
first vision.
What changes were produced in all his actions and ideas by the first vision? I mentioned, first vision is an experience. That experience brings knowledge. What is the knowledge? I had the vision of the Divine Mother. When he had that vision, when he was having that vision, that was called experience. And when that vision vanished, what would the same thing called? Knowledge. Knowledge, that would be called knowledge. That's why it is called recognition. First time, cognition. Thereafterwards, recognition. The master's worship, meditation, etc. underwent novel changes. It is difficult to explain to others that wonderful state of complete absorption in her. There were in that state childlike sincerity, faith, dependence and sweetness only, with the Divine Mother for their stay and support. One point we have to understand here, that this is the condition of all incarnations of God, of all realized souls. Because the experience of God will be same. So what is the difference between a sadhaka, a siddha and an avatara? What is the difference? In the sadhaka, same thing but in small percentage. In a siddha, it is 100%. In an incarnation, it will be 100%. What is the difference? The difference is not in the experience. The difference is not in knowledge. The difference is in power. Experience is the same. But how that experience produces power and how that power differs from person to person, that is a different issue altogether. Ramakrishna used to say, an incarnation can give liberation to millions. And he went to the extent to say, he is called Kapalamochana. Kapalamochana means he can give liberation even to an undeserving person. He can give. How could he give? Because by his potent touch, he will make even the impure mind into the purest mind. It is like you have a cloth and you are a poor person and you have to wash it yourself. Suppose you are a rich person and you have a dirty cloth. What will you do? Washing machine. So Ramakrishna is the biggest, greatest washing machine in this world. That's why it is called Ramakrishna machine. One end goes the dirty dish and the other end comes the stamped, certified, you know, finished product. There were this Chaitanya, Prahlada, all those things. The seriousness of an adult, the personal efforts for the observance of injunctions and prohibitions according to time, place and person, the conducting of oneself with forethought for conforming to both worldliness and godliness, none of these were to be seen in that attitude of his. That is the most wonderful thing. It means a total self-surrender has come. He transcended time, space, conditions, everything, as if he was not there, somebody was sitting there and making him do what he needed to do. Here is an important statement. Whenever one saw him, one thought that he had no will of his own and he had merged his little will and the little ego in the will of her who was the source of all wills. And whatever he did, everything, as if he was completely an instrument in her hand, Sri Ramakrishna became a complete instrument in the hands of whom? The Divine Mother. That was the change. It had come after the vision. That's what will come. The more we advance, you know what happens? This is one easy way of understanding. The more we advance in spiritual life, the more our will gets surrendered to the, merges into the divine will. What does that mean? That means only one thing. What is that one thing? The more we advance in spiritual life, whatever happens in life is accepted joyfully by us. Good, bad, everything. When a person is experiencing joy, what is bad? Everything is only good. Because this good and bad are divided through what category? What judgment? Only that which is happiness, that which is unhappiness. Is it not? If dukkha also is producing joy, and good also, sukha also is producing joy, there is absolutely no difference, then your valuation system itself undergoes complete change, transformation. This is one way to know whether we are progressing in spiritual life. We grow in three areas, Sat, Chit and Ananda. What does it mean in practical terms? We grow in goodness, we grow in wisdom and we grow in Ananda. Whatever happens in life, don't go on blaming anybody. Don't go on saying, this happened because that person did this and other things. Whatever happens, happens by the will of God, Mother. If whatever happens is the will of, will it be good or bad? That is the meaning of singing that song, O Mother, whatever anybody is doing, that is all your will. Shokali tumari ichha. Everything, it is true. I discussed this point almost every class I am discussing it. What is it? Either you call it God's will or you call it your karma phala. It comes to the same. But if you say it is my karma phala, but I am suffering, that means you are not accepted truly your karma phala. The moment you accept 100%, this dukkha, unhappiness becomes reduced. 4. The difference between the previous worship, vision, etc. of the master and after this vision. Previously, Sri Ramakrishna, you know, when he was meditating, worshipping, he used to see one part of the Divine Mother's limbs, either hands or legs. And when he sees one part, he doesn't see the other part. But now, he doesn't see any parts. He is seeing the full. Now he saw, even at times other than those of worship and meditation, the full figure of the effulgent mother, smiling and speaking, guiding and accompanying him, and saying, do this, don't do that. Very important point. Now previously, he had to keep a book, and then he memorizes very soon. He will have to keep that one, and say, first, third item is this, fourth item is this, fifth item is this. You should not do fifth item after the second item. You should do it only after the fourth item. Now, the mother herself is telling that to do this, don't do that. She herself is instructing, like your GPS. Take the second exit. Like that, positively, it tells you. Second exit means what? Don't take
first or
any other exit. This is the state of Shakali Tumari Icha. And the Divine Mother appearing before him, not flashing, standing, sitting in front of him and telling to Thakur, do this, do this, do this, don't do that. If he was going to do something, don't do that, do this. That was the difference. After the, before he had to do it himself. Now he has installed one. You know what is GPS? Guru Parampara system. Here, Divine Mother Parampara system. Formerly, when he offered cooked food, etc., he used to see an extraordinary ray of light coming out, beaming from our eyes, touching all the offered articles, taking their essential parts and withdrawing itself again into her eyes. Now he saw that even before the offering was made, the same mother in her very person sat down to take the offering. He was seeing the mother is taking. But these our ideas about after reading this description should, when she is taking food, is she that figure who is sitting in the temple and taking, or a dog is eating? Who is eating? It is the mother only. Any creature is eating. Who is eating? The Divine Mother. And who is being eaten? It is the Divine Mother only. So in the Taittiri Upanishad we have aham annam, aham annam, aham annam, aham annado, oham annadaha, oham annadaha. Aham annam, aham annadaha. I am food, I am also the eater of the food. It's a wonderful meaning, you know. Very rarely you get these expressions in religious literature. But Upanishads you get that one. Everything is Brahman. Brahma arpanam. Brahma, who is the offerer? Brahman. What is being offered? Brahman. Into what is it is offered? Brahman. Into Brahman. And through which you are offering? Brahman. Through Brahman only. And if a person can think everything is Brahman, and that means the cooking pot is Brahman, and the ladle is Brahman, the fire into which it is offered Brahman, the fire itself is Brahman, the person who is offering is also Brahman. That means sarvam kalvidam Brahma, everything is Brahman. When a person attains to that state, only then he is entitled to say, aham Brahma. Aham Brahma means what? I am the eater, I am the eaten, I am everything else. That is the lofty vision that Sri Ramakrishna had and Gopala Ma also had. Sometimes humanness comes. Then Sri Ramakrishna was seeing the Divine Mother everywhere. Then he had a doubt. Whether you know, whenever you sit, enter into a room, and if there is light, there will be a shadow. And there would be some lamps, oil lamps will be there. So the Divine Mother is there. Sri Ramakrishna was watching whether there would be any shadow on the wall. He could not find any shadow. Then he went, you know, we all breathe. We live because we breathe. If you see any person not breathing, that means what? He's dead. He goes to the Divine Mother, puts his finger there. What does he find? Yes, you know, I put the palm of my hand near her nostrils and felt that mother was actually breathing. I observed very closely, but I could never see the shadow of the mother's divine person on the temple wall in the light of the lamp at night. Why can't he see? Why can't he see? Because she, her body is made up, her form is made up of what? Light. So when two lights are there, one light throws shadow of the other light. Have you ever seen shadow of a light? You will see reflection of a light, but not shadow of the light. Chidabhasa. Because her form is not like our panchabhautika. Also gods and goddesses, when a person has, or even ghosts, you can't see shadow of a ghost. But if you don't see a body and see only shadow, then you will know that it is a ghost. Yeah, sometimes you know, you yourself see, it will take some time to understand that ghost is none other than, there is no other ghost. Then what Hriday said about the master's worship, meditation, etc. One now felt awestruck when one entered the Kali temple, even when the master was not there, let alone when he was. I felt apprehensive about what the Rani and Mathur Babu would think and say when they came to know of it. But such thoughts never crossed Uncle's mind. I saw Uncle prepare an argya consisting of China roses and bilwa leaves, touch his head, bosom, all his limbs, and even his own feet, and at last offer it at the feet of the Divine Mother. He is stretching first his feet and then offering that at the feet of the... We never dare to do it. First of all, we touch her feet, and whatever is touched to her feet will go where? On our heads. But Ramakrishna's vision, that means what? His feet and Divine Mother's feet were the same. He realized the non-separatedness of his own self from the Divine Mother. Hriday continues, I saw his bosom and eyes always reddish like those of a drunkard. Reeling in that condition, he left the worshipper's seat and, ascending the altar, caressed the Divine Mother by affectionately touching her chin and began singing, laughing, joking and conversing with her. Or sometimes he caught hold of her hands and danced. I saw that he, while offered cooked food, etc. to the Divine Mother, got up suddenly, took in his hand a morsel of rice and curry from the plate, touched the Divine Mother's mouth with it and said, Mother, eat it. Do eat it, Mother. Afterwards, perhaps he said, Do you ask me to take it first? You will take it afterwards? Very well. I am taking it now. Saying this, he took a part of it himself and putting the rest into her mouth again and said, I have taken it. You eat it now. One day I found that at the time of the food offering, the master saw a cat enter the temple mewing. He fed it with the food that was to be offered to the Divine Mother, saying, Will you take it, Mother? And fed it actually. Fed whom? No. For us, it is a cat. But for him, it was the Divine Mother. I saw him on some occasions at night put the mother to bed and himself lie on her silver bedstead for some time, saying, Dost thou ask me to lie down? All right, I am doing so. Many people are not aware. When you visit the Kali temple, there is a first floor. And in that first floor, there is a small room. And in that room, there is a small bed. On that bed, the picture of Mother Kali is, you know, when she is woken up, she will be sitting straight. When she is to put to bed, what happens? On a pillow. Ceremonially putting Sri Ramakrishna or Divine Mother to bed. So he used to go there to do this offering, this ceremony, and he used to say, Mother, you want me to sleep? And on that bed, he used to lie down for a few minutes. I have, now you lie down. Then he says, Uncle, I saw again that he sat to worship and became so much absorbed in meditation that he had not the slightest consciousness of the external world for a long time. Uncle rose from his bed very early in the morning and collected flowers in order to make garlands for Mother Kali. At that time too, it seemed to me that there was someone there whom he caressed and with whom he spoke, laughed, joked and made merry and played the importunate child. I saw further that Uncle had not a wink of sleep at night. Whenever I awoke, I found that overwhelmed with spiritual emotions, he was speaking or singing, sometimes went to the Panchavati and was merged in meditation. This was Hriday's description, and he said, Any time I entered into the temple, I felt an awe. There is a fear. Trepidation is there. Was this the only experience of Hriday, or was it the experience of anybody? Anybody. Now what happens? That how long can these things continue? You know what is it? No, formal worship is a separate issue. Here it has gone beyond formalities. It has entered into Raga Bhakti. It is called supreme devotion. Not what is called bound, limited, circumscribed by formalities like first step, second step, third step, etc. But even what happens, he was eating himself and offering it, eaten food, which is called Uchishta, and he was also feeding animals. Suppose a dog entered, what would he have done? He had offered it. For us, it is a dog. For him, it is the Divine Mother. Cat is a Divine Mother. That means he is seeing the Divine Mother, Sarva Bhutastam Atmanam, Sarva Bhutani Chatmani, Ikshate, a man of realization. He sees the same Divine, same Brahman, everywhere. Vidya Vinaya Sampanne, Brahmane, Gavi, Hastini, Shunichaiva, Shvapakecha, Panditaha, Samadarshinaha, a dog, an elephant, a learned Brahmin, an eater of dog, a cow, in everything. He sees only what? The Divine Mother. In fact, it is true. Because what is the dog's body made up of? Panchabhutas. What is my body made up of? Panchabhutas. What is this Sri Ramakrishna's body made up of? Panchabhutas. What is a dead body made up of? Only Panchabhutas. There is no difference at all. When you look from the viewpoint of five elements, there is no difference between one and the other. Living and non-living also, there is no difference. But when we look from the viewpoint of our narrow humanness, our ego is everything. The whole universe is nothing but, if I suffer, the whole world suffers. If I am happy, I am only happy, not the whole world. Yeah, that is our egotism. That's all. If I suffer, then everybody is enjoying, only I am suffering. So, soon the cashier was the most important person, the manager and others, they come sometimes to see the puja, and they see these weird things happen. What did they do? They took an umbrage. They were opposed to it. Genuinely. Not that they were wanting to criticize Thakur, because this is, they have never seen in their life that kind of thing. Neither we have seen. If you see me behaving weirdly there, then you will understand what I am doing. And you will have a glimpse what Sri Ramakrishna, how people used to think about Sri Ramakrishna. They discussed, they came to the conclusion, this kind of worship is destructive for everybody, so that should not continue. They wrote a letter to Madhur Babu. Madhur Babu sent a letter that don't do anything, I will myself come, see what is happening, I will take action. Seventh section of this chapter is telling, Madhur came to see the master's worship and his impression of it. You know what happened? He came and he sat outside the room and he was observing. Sri Ramakrishna, first thing, he was not at all aware. The owner of the temple has come to observe. His whole life depends upon his judgment. He was not at all aware. He was dancing, he was singing, he was caressing the Divine Mother, he was weeping, he was laughing, he was telling everything. One question, was he telling jokes to the Divine Mother? Definitely he will be telling. Because the Divine Mother is, this is my mother. Yeah, everything he will be telling. That's my guess anyway. He had seen, and something happened. His others also had seen. Because once they suspect somebody, they specially come to see how he was behaving. Is it not? It is. That's why we are all called Sahasraksha. You know Sahasraksha? 1,000 eyes. What does that mean? We are like huge telescopes. What is that? When we are looking at the faults of other people, we put the telescope in the right way. When we are looking at our faults, we reverse it. So, when we are looking at other people, 1,000 eyes observing everything. So, they must have seen, specially, how he was behaving throughout the puja time. And they came, because Ramakrishna was never aware who is watching and who is not watching, who is coming, who is not coming. He was not observing at all. They wrote a very negative report, and Madhur Babu, he knew something, intuition. And then he came, he saw, what was his impression of Sri Ramakrishna's worship? He knew that Sri Ramakrishna is the greatest pujari anybody has got in the world at that time. So he exclaimed, Mother will awaken very soon. He did not understand. Mother was already awake. And then he went back and wrote a letter that do not do anything, let the Bhattacharya do anything he likes. And these people were not happy because they genuinely thought, not that they were against Thakur. This is the normal behavior. Now, what is my point? How did Madhur Babu get that kind of understanding? By whose grace? Buddhi yogam dadamyaham. If anybody prays and worships me, I will give right understanding to them. So, who gave that right understanding to Madhur Babu? It's the Divine Mother. Because it is for the interest of whom? both for Sri Ramakrishna, and Madhur Babu was also blessed. But this drama, suppose Madhur Babu did not get that understanding, what would have been his reaction? He would have dismissed. If he had dismissed, then Sri Ramakrishna would not have been there. If he had dismissed, most unfortunate, you would not have to attend the class today. But you know, it's all Divine Mother's will. There is nothing. This is the truth. Nothing happens by our will, by our karma. That is a fact we have to understand. The master attained ragatmika bhakti through his intense love of God, and the result of that bhakti. What is it? It is a big, this thing. It passed beyond the prescribed limit of devotion enjoined by the scriptures and took a speedy course along the exalted path of pure devotional love. But this change came in such a simple, natural way that even Sri Ramakrishna himself could not understand it clearly, let alone others. We see him think sometimes, what is happening to me? Am I on the right track? He therefore eagerly prayed to the Divine Mother. I don't know and don't understand, Mother, what these things are that are happening to me. Please make me do what I am to do. Teach me what you want me to learn and reveal thyself to me. Continue always to hold me by the hand. He made his mind turn away from lust, gold, honor, fame, and all other powers and enjoyments of the world, and said those words imploringly from the bottom of his heart to the Divine Mother. Very important point. We also pray, but God doesn't listen to our prayers. You know why? Because we have not given up the other things. Like Hajra, Sri Ramakrishna used to observe him. Hajra prays to God. He does japa. But what is his attitude? Sri Ramakrishna says. He says, God, you can give me devotion. Along with that, some money also is welcome. It is okay. You know, you have got money, you have got everything. Give a little bit of it. What will you lose? So he wants both. He was a very fortunate soul to be able to live with Sri Ramakrishna. Don't forget it. That is also Leela. But Sri Ramakrishna, he said, I don't want all those things. I want only you and nothing else. The mother of the universe also fulfilled his prayer. Unasked, she brought him whenever necessary, whatever necessary, all those things and all those persons that were required for the growth and perfection of his life as an aspirant, and made him easily reach and naturally the ultimate goal of pure knowledge and pure devotion. What is that goal? Aham Brahmasmi. Now, complete identity with the Divine. The Divine Lord has promised to his devotees through the Gita. You know, Ananyas Chintayanto Mam, E Janaha Pariupasate, Tesham, Nityavi Uktanam, Yoga Kshemam, Ohamyaham. To those of undivided minds who worship and always remain united with me, and who place their whole minds in me, and do not think even of their own food and movements necessary for life, I bring, even unasked, all the things they require. The more we study the life of the Master at this time, the more shall we be surprised and astounded to understand how literally that promise in the Gita was fulfilled in his life. It became necessary to prove clearly again the truth of that promise of the Divine Lord in this selfish modern age. Some Sharadam says, listen to this, O man, with a pure heart, and advance on the path of renunciation according to your capacity. What is most important here for us to understand? That Sri Ramakrishna was an incarnation of God. And he incarnated for whose benefit? Our benefit. The first thing he proved, if anyone surrenders himself totally to God, then God will look after him in the form of whatever is necessary, he will bring. It's called yoga. Whatever is brought, whatever necessary things are brought, he himself will protect, so that nobody can take those things away from his devotees. This is called kshema. To give what is necessary and to protect what is necessary, this is called kshema. Yoga kshemam vahamyaham. This is the promise by Bhagavan Krishna in the Gita. Bhagavan Krishna means what? Incarnation. God himself promised. And to prove once again, and this promise will be beholden for how long? For eternity. Any devotee, after a billion years, if he totally surrenders to God, God is there to protect him, to look after him, to do whatever is necessary. That is the one of the reasons why God incarnates, to prove his own promise once more, so that others also can have faith in God, God's promise, and then advance in spiritual life. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.